The subject today is probably of one which is very dear to all of our hearts, which is intra-EAC trade. Last statistics I saw, and I'm sure the Waziri will confirm, is that the EAC is an outlier in the African trading blocs when it comes to intra-trade. And it's been a tremendous success, and there's plenty more to go for, I'd like to think. I'm not going to go through the objectives of today's symposium. I think James, who's going to make some opening remarks. James Muroi is the Kenya National Chamber Director, and he's the chair of the Economic Diplomacy Committee, and he's just telling me he's now moved into farming as well. So James, if we can kindly ask you to make the opening remarks, I'd be grateful. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ali, Cabinet Secretary, Ad Mohammed, panelists, and fellow businessmen and women, a good morning. I know we are starting late, and Ali has just warned us that we're going to be on the fast lane, so just be prepared. We're going to sort of guillotine some of what we were supposed to do. But this morning, I am delighted, first of all, to welcome the Cabinet Secretary, who's just been given the new portfolio, Industrialization, Trade, and Investment. And for me, that's like a man who's being asked to talk about the sun, the moon, and the stars, because it's a very wide portfolio. But I can tell you without a shadow of doubt that our Cabinet Secretary is equal to that challenge, and we are all excited in the business community to welcome him to this new portfolio and promise our support in that regard. My name is James Mareu, and as Ali has said, I'm the chairman of the Economic Diplomacy Committee at the Chamber of Commerce, and I'm here on behalf of my national chairman, who apparently had to fly out to the Netherlands for some urgent meeting, and so I stepped in his place. This morning, we are going to be looking at an interesting topic that's been a buzzword around the community. It's the intra East African trade challenges and opportunities for business. And when you talk about challenges, they're constant, they're everywhere. But this session is designed to inform key stakeholders, policy makers, and private sector on opportunities that enhanced trade integration in the East African community can bring in terms of new opportunities for businessmen and women within the region. You all know that the adage or the saying that if you want to walk fast, walk alone. But if you want to walk far, walk together with others. And I think this is very appropriate within the East African community, that we are seeing more and more integration, and the need is driven by the fact that if you have the East African community, for example, as a community working together, then we are looking at a population of about 170 million. Anybody producing for that region has got a captive market already within that region. But again, if you look at what is happening around the world, there are more mergers, there are more integrations, blocks are forming, and this is because of a strategic reason that you enlarge your market as you integrate. It is also aimed, the session is also going to look at providing stakeholders with sound grounding of factors affecting trade and business within the region. The dialogue will not only provide an overview of the recent trade and development trends in the region, but will address those issues which have been most direct bearing on the East African business. And those issues are many. We have been talking about opening up transit corridors, we've been opening up single trade windows where you have a one-stop center, we're having customs unions within the region, and other trade facilitation effects that are taking place so that we can make trade easier and better. I mean, doing business is difficult, as it were, and I think within the context of the East African community, we are trying to alleviate this through systems such as integration. And recently, the president inaugurated the port charter in Mombasa, which is ideally meant to create a corridor that transit goods transiting from Mombasa to either Rwanda, Burundi, Uganda, and Southern Sudan can be faster and more efficient. And this is where we say time is money. And if you look at the transit time that it used to take to transit goods from Mombasa to Kigali was 36 days, down to 4 days. It just means we're doing very well as a region. The context of our conversation will be around trade integration. And really, we are looking at what is it that we can do as a region. If you look around the world, the trading blocks in Europe and in other Asian countries, and even a country like America, for example, is a big trading block, because all the states are like small countries, all trading, and the market they offer there is what is exciting for the business community. As a community, we are also looking at the challenges that have bedeviled us, many of which are not insurmountable, but which have persisted. For example, the infrastructure challenge is one major one, and I'm happy to say that with the advent of the standard gauge railway that started from Mombasa, once it crosses through the country and through Uganda and through to Rwanda, I can assure you that will be a big solution on our hands. The other issue, of course, is the need for us to trade more within ourselves, the intra-East African community trading. And as you probably already know, Kenya is a major FDI within the region, but we would like to see more balance of trade within the region so that we are able to balance off, and there's no feeling that one is oppressed because the other one is. We're trying to bring everyone up together. And that can only be achieved, again, if we set out sound rules about how to do business within the region. Our president has also reiterated and spoken a lot about intra-Africa. And that, to me, is our ultimate solution, the ultimate solution for Africa. Because as long as you're trading alone, as long as Kenya is trying to do business within Kenya, it is such a small market, it is almost negligible. But the sooner we appreciate and understand that we are only doing 10% intra-Africa trade. If you look at Europe, I think they are at something like 45 to 50% within Europe. And you find for them, as long as they are busy working together and doing business together, anything they do outside of their own operation is a by the way. And indirectly, because of what they have been doing, they've been able to create employment within their countries because of those inter-regional trade. For us in Africa, I think we've been left and we've developed other regions rather than develop our own. And for me, I think even as we interact with this conversation, I think it's important that we tell ourselves that we must start by trading within ourselves. Within ourselves, look at our competitive advantages and be able to throw this out to our neighbors and look at what they have competitively. For example, why would anybody look for tea anywhere else other than Kenya within the region? And why would we look for matoke elsewhere other than Uganda? And why would you go looking for baboons anywhere other than Rwanda? You know, we have to look at what we have and start using that. And so I think, ladies and gentlemen, I know we are on a fast lane. I don't know how much time we have, but I think I want to just use that as an opening general statement where we open ourselves to all this. And I want to say this. If you look at the modern war today, there's no longer economic power. And who has the power calls the shots. I mean, if I'm controlling the economy of a big block, then obviously you get to listen to me. And we've seen that with some of our big brothers. So it is a question of how can we make East Africa strong and thereafter make COMESA region, for example. East Africa is a part of COMESA region. Can we make even COMESA stronger? And then by extension, go on and make the tripartite, which is now the convergence of about 600-700 million people coming together to form one trading block, the tripartite, That is exciting for any businessman. That is exciting for any investor coming into the region. And so as we discuss this, let's open ourselves to all these possibilities. They are many and varied. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, James. And if I might quickly just reintroduce everybody, because I know we started a little bit late and I did not introduce everyone properly. Let me first turn. Sitting next to me on my left is the Honorable Aidan Mohammed, the Cabinet Secretary for Industrialization and Trade. And of course, has had some very significant triumphs lately. Kenya went up very dramatically in the ease of doing business. And I've known Honorable Aidan Mohammed for a long time, and he doesn't blow his trumpet, but he's made significant progress, and I say that, I think, on behalf of the entire panel. Then on the Cabinet Secretary's left is Samuel Makomi. He's the Managing Director for Kenya, for Kenya Commercial Bank. Of course, that's the biggest piece of the pie for KCB. KCB is a big beast in the East African region. We've just heard from James, and thank you so much for those opening remarks. I think if I can just add on a couple, I think one of the challenges for Africa has been the fact that we have been fragmented when it comes to the negotiating table. It's sometimes difficult to get everyone's agenda aligned and presented. You know, somewhere like China, you've got one letterbox, whereas in Africa, we have several. Then to the left of James is James Shikwati, who's going to speak next. He's a friend of mine from Twitter. That's where we began, James, I think, and we've had lots of interesting conversations. James is the director of the Inter-Region Economic Network and will be our next speaker. And on James's left is Willie Sorini, who is the Director of Strategic Partnerships at Pfizer Inc. and will participate in the panel. If I can now turn to James Shikwati for some remarks, please. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me to share a few thoughts about this very exciting region, the East Africa community. I'll start from, first of all, giving a practical example, because in my line of work and the vision of my organization, we've always pushed for, you know, African market and East Africa community market, and we don't just push for it, but we go a step further to prepare East Africans for the same. Because we'll notice, even as we talk about low trade capacity in the region, and as we talk about inability to negotiate from one point as Africa, the key challenge is that if you do not have people who are actors, remember politicians are elected after every 5-year cycle, so they might not have that capability to start thinking about long-term. So what we've done at Inter-Region Economic Network, we've gone a step further to target startups in the 5 East African countries and SMEs as well, and we train them to be export ready, and we train them to be investor ready. Why we do this? It's because we know that unless we go down to the nuts and bolts to have young people who are already excited and keen to tap into the regional market, then it's not going to be easy to achieve this goal. And as we speak, I'm happy to report that we already have a cohort of 120 East African under 35 who own SMEs that we're working together. And come the month of May 2016, they'll be converting here in Nairobi to pitch to investors and tell investors, let us grow together so that we can move to the next step. And now, just a little overview about the region. I think we have good news and bad news at the same time. The good news, of course, being that the trade
among the East African member states has been on a steady increase,
and countries such as Kenya will boast of at least having its lead export destination being in the East Africa Community region. So that gives us at least a positive element that it's not just hot air, something is actually happening. And then when we look at the averages in terms of the trade in the region, as per the figures of 2011, we see that we already had recorded $4.96 billion worth of trade in the region. And then, of course, when we evaluate in terms of how the five countries are able to trade together compared to other regions, you'll notice that we stand at 11% of regional trade compared to 45% in the Americas and compared to 60% in the EU. So in other words, our key focus would be how can we grow this further so that now that we all speak Swahili and we call ourselves East Africans, we should shoot this percentage from 11% all the way to possible 100%. So my key message really is for this to happen, we need to identify the key nuts and bolts for the region. And for me, the key nuts and bolts for the region are the small and medium-sized enterprises. Because you'll notice that the figures that we celebrate so much about trade, it's about mostly retail. And I see very low figures when it comes to production. So it concerns me that we'll still be talking about trade, but then when it comes to manufacturing, producing the actual goods, we have very low numbers. So you'll notice that, for example, the small and medium-sized enterprises in the region, which account for almost 75% of the activity that we have, they're mostly in the wholesale and retail, which means we are literally converting the East Africa community into a huge supermarket. And in my view, that's not a positive development. I'd like to see a possibility where we can convert the East Africa community into a huge factory for Africa and for the rest of the world. And especially bearing in mind that we are strategically positioned along the Indian Ocean. And we know that the Indian Ocean carries close to 80% of trade volumes globally. Part of what is being discussed here at WTO, without the Indian Ocean, there'll be no WTO because that's exactly where the highest percentage of movement of goods takes place. So the question would be, what stake does East Africa community have in the movements in the Indian Ocean if you are simply focusing on being a big consumer region? So maybe to conclude, because as we've had about time, and we'd like to have some conversation on this, I would say that it would be my wish to have a sense of purpose, and in this particular case, look at how to grow startups and SMEs so as to graduate them to the private sector. If you have a private sector that is vibrant, it is the private sector that will enable us to have joint interest, because they'll have a stake. It won't just be about politics. It will be about bottom lines. They'll be looking at, if you make this deal at WTO, what does it translate in terms of our business? But if we have mostly retailers who are just importing from the countries that are here at the WTO pushing for access to markets, then you have a big challenge when you're meeting such countries, because they can always tell you, we'll build a highway for you, we'll build a standard gauge railway for you, and maybe to bring in goods. But we'd like to have a scenario where we have all this being built, and we're also focusing on how to get our goods out there. So finally, I would say that I would wish to see a possibility where we have a proactive strategy to activate productivity and then activate markets. So it's not enough to have good policies, good protocols, and we do not have a proactive game plan on how to tap into these East Africans, especially the youthful population, in order to make the region thrive in the continent and in the global markets. Thank you.
Thank you, James, for that very interesting intervention. Just to mention one thing, I completely agree with James's idea about the Indian Ocean. I think we're going to see an incredible resurgence and renaissance in the Indian Ocean. And I remember reading a book about it and saying that it was always an enormous trading system because of what's called the reversible escalator monsoon wind. And that meant that you could actually sail all the way from near China to all the way to Maputo, and the wind would turn around in the same year, and it would take you all the way back. And it was that created this extraordinary trading system, and I think we're going to see its resurgence again for a number of reasons. So, James, that was a very interesting point that you made. Now, for our headline event today, it is a real pleasure to ask the Cabinet Secretary, Honorable Aidan Mohammed, who's the Cabinet Secretary for Industrialization and Trade and Investment in Kenya. Waziri, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ali Khan. First of all, ladies and gentlemen, you know, if you drive through Nairobi now, it's not one of those very nice scenes. But it's good, you know. One of the other things that I do until my new successor is sworn in is also the Minister for Agriculture. And whenever it rains, it's quite, you know, a blessing. And that is really, really good for our country. But this is the week of trade, week where everybody in the world talks about trade. And we're very happy and honored to have the global ministers of trade through the WTO converging here in Nairobi to discuss what is going to happen in the future on key issues around international trade. Let me start by, first of all, putting into context what actually constitutes to a large extent international trade. And this was something that was quite interesting as part of my initial induction into Ministry of Industrialization. Nearly three-quarters of global trade is in manufactured goods. And if you are not manufacturing anything, then you are not able to trade anything. You can be a recipient, you can be the country to which things get imported into, but you don't have much to actually sell. And so one of the biggest challenges and biggest opportunity that the continent of Africa has identified is to focus on increasing its productive capacity through focus on industrialization. And so if you go through the AU meetings, if you hear what the African Union leaders talk about, the focus now is we must industrialize and industrialize quickly. And so wherever you go, you will be seeing this song. And many countries are trying their best to actually make that happen. There are a number of challenges, a lot of them historical, that may have stopped Africa from becoming one of the industrialized nations. But guess what? A lot of those bottlenecks have now been understood and they are being dealt with. The only problem is some of these solutions take time to be delivered, but the journey has started and a lot of improvements is happening. So for example, energy cost is one of the biggest challenges that, you know, in order to produce or manufacture anything, you've got to deal with that. I was in Lusaka last week attending a COMESA meeting, and I think for nearly half a day there was no power. And I asked some of the industries what's happening, and they said, oh, we have generators. Now, how can you compete on that? And so South Africa is going through similar challenges, of course, Kenya and many other countries. But the level of investments in those areas, you can only take the lead and example from what Kenya is doing, where we're increasing the amount of energy supply from 1,500 about 2 years ago to potentially 6,500 in the next 3 to 5 years. And so that journey is started. We are going to win. we must start making sure that we can produce so that we can be active participants of global trade. That, I think, is something that we'll get along and we'll kind of start pushing. Now, until that happens, we will have to deal with some of the things that we produce. And we produced largely today agricultural items. So the continent of Africa is an agricultural, you know, part of the world, will continue to be that, will continue to feed the world. As you may have heard, over 60% of arable land in the world is now in Africa, and that is what we produce. Now, if you then link that to global trade, one of the biggest challenges that will be discussed in the next 3 days at WTO here in Nairobi would be the issue around agriculture and market access of agricultural products. It's probably the single most contentious issue between developed countries as well as developing countries, where we produce agricultural products, we need market access into these developed countries, but there are a whole raft of issues, including subsidies that are provided by these developed countries to their farmers in their countries, effectively locking out agricultural produce out of the developed world by making it much more expensive if they are not subsidized. So that is a topic which I will encourage you to watch and listen carefully and follow on how that is going to be resolved. So that's really where we are. That's what the opportunities that we have. That is what we are pushing to trade. And in the absence of that, what we are doing as part of industrialization on the continent is to really use agriculture as the entry point by processing of agricultural products and be able to reach the world market. So that is really the context that I just wanted to lay out first before I get into East Africa, which is the real reason why we are here. I think on the East African side, East Africa is probably the only block on the continent of Africa that is mentioned every time on the success that we've been able to achieve. There are so many good things that are happening, yet, you know, there are still a few challenges. And let me just highlight some of those really good and positive stories that have happened. The first and most important thing about any regional integration and activities within a block like EAC is the willingness and the political commitment of its leaders in making the East African community work. And we are very happy and lucky that every 2 to 3 months, East African heads of state do meet in different capital cities to discuss, highlight, and resolve issues that are causing us trouble. So the questions normally that are asked, you know, many of you would have had the Northern Corridor Project meeting, that's what it's called. What is working, what is not working, what needs to move much faster, what needs to be taken out of the way, are things that get discussed. And really, I have been into these meetings a number of times, and I'm convinced that if we have one more year of this, we're going to go very far as East Africa. The level of commitment and, you know, spend on infrastructure project is immense. And this is just to make it easy for businesses to operate on a lower cost basis, whether you talk about standard gauge railway that is going to link Kenya, Uganda into Rwanda, or the road development, or the port of Mombasa. A lot is being done to make sure that we become one region, one successful region. And that's working very well. Increasingly, we are injecting some of our ideas with private sector minds. And just in Kenya alone, I think 2 weeks ago, the president made some appointments, and two of the principal secretaries that will be dealing with issues of this, one is Betty Maina, who used to be the Kenya Association of Manufacturers, a very strong, well-versed person on the issue of trade and businesses and manufacturing. And then we have Chris Kipto from Trademark East Africa. These are the people who are going to now be spearheading some of the issues resolving the problems and building on the opportunities and the successes that we've been able to achieve as well. So there is a willingness of actually getting the private sector to be part of resolving these issues as opposed to just waiting from government to actually make things work for them. And I think one of the most exciting story that I like to share with people whenever I talk about East Africa is 2 years ago, I drove from the port of Mombasa to the Malaba border on Uganda. And I just wanted to understand why it takes 18 days for a container to move from the port of Mombasa to the Malaba border when, you know, if you are driving a four-wheel drive, you'll get there in half a day. And it was amazing, some of the discoveries that we made, and many of you who have traveled on these roads would know that to get out of the port is a nightmare. Immediately outside of the port, where the police officer has just checked you inside the port, outside the gate you will be checked again. And before you leave Miritini, there are 2-3 other roadblocks, and by the time you reach Mariakani, those of you who know these roads, they are not very far apart, these places that I'm mentioning. And so at each of these points are really just opportunities to slow things down, to ask for some, you know, gifts here and there. And the weighbridges are all, you wonder, you know, the weighbridges are not too far apart, what's happening. And the nightmare was when I reached the Malaba border, when I saw 7-kilometer-long queue of trucks trying to enter Uganda. So we crossed into Uganda customs. Luckily, we don't need a visa. And we tried to understand what was going on. And so the issue of making things work and trade move was really, really a nightmare. So we came back to the drawing board and, you know, we're stopping drivers on the road asking, so how long did it take you to come from Mombasa to Webuye, it was at the time? And the guy said, 7 days. Well, if you asked the police and the others, they will tell you, oh, no, you know, these drivers have homes in every town, so they like to sleep, but it has nothing to do with us. And so everybody was pointing finger to the other. But so the long and short of it is, I think the 18 days reduced to now anywhere between 4 days, if you are lucky, to about 6 days. And we are talking about leaving the port of Mombasa, going to Uganda, and then back. And that is just an example of what, if there is a willingness and the commitment on all the governments to actually make things move forward. So what I would like to say is we have the mindset in the right space. We have the commitment of the private sector, willing to support, willing to share some of the issues. The government that is so willing, every time these Northern Corridor meetings happen, the private sector is taken along to make sure that whatever is decided is not to the detriment of the private sector, but is going to facilitate and make things happen. And so a lot is going on. There are issues, of course, that we still have to deal with at each of our national governments level. There is, you know, until we eradicate our national interest versus East African interests, we will still have a few teething problems here and there. And so one of the things that we believe would resolve some of that is that any success that happens within East Africa is shared success. That it shouldn't be one country benefiting at the expense of the other, and we just want to make sure that that is something that can be dealt with in a manner that is transparent and everybody feels contribution to their wealth creation of the people and the business community in those respective countries. So I think a lot is happening. More needs to be done, of course. One of the key things as part of the WTO meeting in Bali 2 years ago was an agreement reached on trade facilitation. And trade facilitation is one of the most important areas that WTO has reached an agreement on. I'm very pleased to say that Kenya has signed that agreement, it's ratified by its parliament. And the most important part of that is just to make sure that trade happens easily and we don't frustrate things happening around borders. You know, one of the things we discovered as part of that trip we made that time is, I wouldn't mention which country, but in one of the countries in East Africa, the trucks spend more than half the time stationary at border control points. More than half the time. And less of that actually on the road, trying to do what it should be doing. And so trade facilitation is a really key component of that. As I said, we have ratified that in the country, and it will do a lot. But I think East Africa, more than any of the other regions that I've seen or heard of, is already well advanced, and there is agreements, consensus of making sure that things work and work well as far as making trade move forward. One of the biggest challenge, of course, and this is really just my concluding remarks, I'd like to spend a lot more time hearing from you some of the things on your mind, is trade facilitation, whilst it's fantastic and it's good, always raises the question about why we have all the containers that are coming from the port of Mombasa full of products. And when they are going back to Mombasa, nearly half of them are empty. And that is where people believe that Africa becomes the trading nation as opposed to the producing nation. And that is why the continent's leadership is focused so much on the side of production. And that is something that we need to do and make sure that the trade globally is balanced, it's fair, and everybody is benefiting, so that we can have the national global cake, whatever it is, shared in a fair manner. So I'm sure there's a lot more to be talked about. The bigger global issues on trade is being talked about in WTO, where we are actively participating, but really to say, kudos to all the participants in East Africa, the private sector, and we should not be sidetracked by some of the teething problems that you hear about. I think if you look at the big picture and the road ahead, there's much more positives than downsides. So thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, and I look forward to good deliberation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, for some very interesting remarks and about that journey from Mombasa to Malabar. You're braver than I would be. I don't know if I could take those number of days and handle that. So thank you very much. Lots of interesting points raised there and lots of significant achievements in a short space of time. If I can now turn to Sam, for our panel discussion, and I'll take some questions. If anyone's got some burning questions from the audience, please put up your hand as well. Sam, being a regional bank, first bank to be licensed, I believe, in Ethiopia from here. Congratulations on that. I saw the CEO was very excited when he visited. What advice would you give to one who wants to expand regionally across the board? Imagine we're a small business, a big business. Is it, what would you say are the key drivers for companies who are looking to go East African?
Yeah, thank you, Adam. I think first of all, as KCB, one of the things we have done from some time back was we were courageous to go into the region very early. We've been in Tanzania for the last 18 years, and by about 3 years ago, we were already in every East African country. So we are truly the first regional bank, the only bank with a presence in all 5 countries of East Africa. So part of it is just agreeing to take the leadership role that these places require to be opened. If you look at a country like South Sudan, and some people may be aware, there has been a change in the currency just this week. We have been courageous, even in a place like South Sudan, to go. We've been in every single province of South Sudan, despite all the challenges. And even from the time that South Sudan went through some turbulence in 2013, we've never closed even a single day. So part of it requires you to have a pioneering spirit, to have the courage to open up. Ethiopia, as much as we've gotten a license, it does not give us a license to open a full bank. It's a representative office, but we've said we have to have the courage to start there, to start understanding the trade flows, and to start having a leadership role in the region. I think, so we already saw this and started opening up country by country from about 17 years ago. So we've had the courage to go out and to know that it's part of it is a long-term strategy rather than just something that's very, very short-term. I think from the time, what you would see at the moment, like if you look at bank, at least 7 Kenyan banks now have at least some presence in quite a bit of the region. So a lot of banks now have realized that it's very important to create a regional footprint to try and enable money flows, because trade flows means money flows. So I think there has been that realization that more people need to get into this and to facilitate trade flows, payments, to start syndicating for loans and larger credits across the region. And one has to say that it's an opportunity, and it's an opportunity that's got to be taken. And what you'll also realize, at the moment we're the largest regional bank in East Africa, but more banks, what's happened is that the regional banks are now realizing they have to take a leadership role. In the past, we relied a lot more on other banks, maybe foreign banks who had a bigger presence. But now the regional banks from East Africa, especially Kenya, have decided that you have to create a leadership role as banks. And we've even seen other banks, like Tanzanian banks, CRDB, now opening up in Burundi. So we are seeing it becoming now a trend of more banks thinking that they should open up the trade flows, payment flows, and also credit for the region. So it's about deciding that even when so many people complain about that some things are not opened up, opportunities are not strong enough, but even our entry into Ethiopia is to say we have the courage, we've started the journey, we've started the partnership, we are learning, we are starting to facilitate and understand the trade flows, and ultimately we'll get where we are going. So we're very excited, and what we've seen as KCB is that the share of the regions is becoming bigger and bigger in terms of contribution to KCB as a group. And part of it also has been about the learning, because when you go into other markets, you get to learn things that you did not know, and you keep improving. So Tanzania, which we struggled with because it was part of our learning process, has now become one of our biggest and most important countries. So I think it's a learning journey, but we are very, very excited. The more you learn, the more you improve, and we expect that the region itself would ultimately contribute 20 to 25% to the group.
Thank you very much. Mentioning South Sudan, I was just, you were saying a pioneer spirit. Yesterday they sort of devalued the currency by about 85%. So you got to be strong as well, and to take that kind of volatility. It's not, if I can, I'm going to come to the audience, but if I can just turn to Willie Cerrone, who hasn't had a chance to speak so far. He's the Director of Strategic Partnerships at Pfizer. Can I turn to and ask you, do you think Africa, I mean, sitting where you are, big multinational, do we have a trade mindset, Willie? Do you think, you know, we are pro-trade, that our mindset is right? Or what are your thoughts?
Definitely Africa is pro-trade, because if it wasn't, it wouldn't be receiving, because trade is a two-way traffic. You can be receiving, also sending. The part that Africa is not yet strong in is in sending. And that's why the comment was made that Africa is turning into a big supermarket. Africa needs to export also. In order for Africa to become a participant in sending, it must develop some key capabilities and understand some very critical sectors that are important to develop. Pfizer is a player in the healthcare sector, in the pharmaceutical sector. And let me give a brief touch into the pharmaceutical sector, some of the numbers we are talking about. Globally, it's a $1 trillion economy, the pharmaceutical sector. The U.S. is about half a trillion. It should be about half a trillion by 2030. Presently, it's about $450 billion. The EU is about 200 billion euro. And very rapidly come down, sub-Saharan Africa, the entire of it is about $35 billion. And then you come to East Africa, is about $1.8 billion. Now you can see the decimation of numbers as you come down in terms of participation in the pharmaceutical sector. And this is a key driver of healthcare. And healthcare is a key driver of the consuming capacity of the population, because health is a good thing. The contrast again is you go to the US. The level of regulation that happens in the big economies versus the small economies. In the US, if you're a player in the US, you'll work with only one regulatory agency, one regulator. And with one regulator, you'll file your product and you'll play in a $450 billion market. You come to a $35 billion market, which is sub-Saharan Africa, you have to work with close to 48 regulatory agencies. So there is over-regulation. You come to East Africa, you have to play in a market of 1.8 billion shillings, dollars. You now have to deal with five regulatory agencies. Luckily, East Africa is moving ahead of the rest because it has created a unified regulatory agency that covers East Africa. But the governments in the region must be emphatic and weed out the others so that only one is left standing. So presently we have the East Africa regulation and then country-specific regulations. The last comment I want to make about the pharmaceutical industry is that it doesn't favor, it's not size-dependent in terms of exports. So Africa can play. It doesn't have to have the large scale in terms of consumption to be able to export. All you need is capability, technical competence, have the right infrastructure. It is really manpower and facilities. It is not so much markets. And that is the reason why you have a country like Ireland. In its size and scale of population, it exports close to 8 times the export capabilities of India. Pharmaceutical industry is a big lever that East Africa can play with to enable exports. It is not size dependent, it is competence, and it is facilities, and it's largely people. We can do that. Thank you.
Thank you. Very interesting comments about fragmentation and basically that fragmentation costing much more to address smaller markets. And just to touch on Ireland, because it's been a real turnaround story, that was interesting you mentioned. And I saw some GDP numbers out of there recently, which were very, very strong. And I think there's a lot of work being done with Enterprise Ireland and Enterprise Kenya as well, which we're glad about. If I can now turn, I know you had a burning question, if I can possibly take two questions and then I'll revert to, if you don't mind introducing yourself, and if we can keep it to one question, I'd be really grateful. You've turned Kenyan already. It's always three questions.
Okay, then it's fine. Thank you very much. My name is Marita Wigertale from Oxfam, Germany. And I would like to come back to what you have said, Honorable Minister, first. On agriculture within the WTO, because I think that Kenya, for example, has been one of the countries that had, according to FAO, about 100 import surges within the last 30 years of a special safeguard mechanism that is envisaged also to protect against cheap imports from industrialized countries with a high level of subsidies is a very important issue. I was just wondering with regard to tariff escalation in the EU, is this an issue which you think is necessary to tackle? And secondly, when it comes to manufacturing, I think it's really important to have a food processing and manufacturing industry, especially with regard to small and medium enterprises. However, when it comes to history shows that manufacturing has only been possible when there was a tariff protection. And no country in the world developed their manufacturing without tariff protection. So my question is with regard to the international level, with the NAMA negotiations, there was this whole issue about less than full reciprocity and very, very little space to protect really industrial goods. And with regard to the EU AAC EPA, I was wondering, do you have enough policy space to protect really your the industrial goods and also processed food imported by the EU? Because this is, where, of course, the endeavor of the EU is, they are very keen on exporting processed food and also industrial goods. So I was wondering if
Thank you. Do you want to Shall I take two? There's one more question. I think the lady here was going to ask if we can just take that.
Yeah, thank you very much for your presentations. My question is actually on the role of innovation in promoting intra-EAC trade, given that economies in the 21st century are not so much driven by factors or the resources we have, but largely innovation-driven.
Thank you. And I'll take one more from just in front.
Thank you, Ali. My name is Rajiv Arora. I work for the Minister, Ministry of Industrialization and Enterprise Development. I would like to give a little bit of a statement first for 30 seconds and then probably have two questions to the panel. The statement being is that in the last 2 months, we have been very much involved in understanding the needs of the SMEs through the Ministry, and we actually held a platform for inviting more than 538 SMEs on the 9th of November and actually engaged with them to understand the needs of what they really need to move forward with for becoming export-oriented or industrialized to be able to access the markets. And three key issues which came out from various, sectors and we had engaged in the discussion was the market access. The other was finance. And the third was incubation. Those are the three key challenges which the SMEs were facing. So my question here is, and we found out later that there's so much finance available for the SMEs in various banks, and one of them is right sitting here in the panel, KCB, who has put up an SME fund. And subsequently, I attended another forum of FSG, which invited all the banks on the 3rd of December, where practically all the banks of Kenya were in one room. And the same things were being discussed of the challenges, and they had actually done some interventions to go to the banks discreetly to find out what support is being given to SMEs. And the same challenge was found, the financial issues. So my question is, if we have the fund available, what is the face of the bank which is actually describing the modus operandi of engaging with the SMEs? Do they really understand how to engage with them? Because most of the SMEs dread going to the bank, firstly, and if they do, they are actually shunted out very quickly and say, what kind of equity you can bring, or what give us the project proposal. So I think they need to be understood that they are a different breed. They have to be handled differently. They are not industrialized. They are not big businesses. They have to be really brought into an understanding how to access that. So I would like to understand from the MD of KCB. The other one is the information. The second question which I would like to challenge you and probably ask you, where do we get the information from demand side of East Africa alone, forget the world? Do we really know what the demand is in the East Africa for the SMEs or any enterprise to access? While we are exporting to all over the world, we don't really know what our neighbors' needs are and who are the suppliers, so supply side as well. And that has been the largest a challenge for the SMEs or for the enterprise to understand the market needs. So I think it's important someone should take up that, and probably you should guide us who, to put up that information for easy access. So information, which is probably the most important tool for business development. So information and market.
Just to respond to that quickly, I think we live in an information century. Information is probably the most valuable currency of all. So I completely agree with you. And just to touch on that point, what I found interesting was I was buying some bananas in Nakumatt, and I looked up the price of the same bananas at Walmart in the United States, and they were cheaper in Walmart than they were in Nakumatt. So reverting back to your point, I think there's an enormous opportunity here with much higher margins, if people look at them, look at it closely enough. If I can now condense and go back to the questions, I think, Cabinet Secretary, the first question was yours, very EU-focused, tariff escalation, manufacturing value addition, and saying that basically no industrialization has ever happened without some kind of tariff protection.
Well, increasingly, the issue of tariffs and using tariffs to protect, I think it's being phased out and is becoming untenable over time. What everybody is advocating for and pushing is to open up the world, remove distortions, and let there be fair play.
So you have access to this market, access to the other market, but really by removing the issues of distortion, giving people unfair advantage. And I think the points on agriculture that I was talking about is there's a significant amount of distortion, especially around agriculture within some of the developed worlds, where most African countries are looking to export their agricultural produce to. That continues to be a challenge. It is important for those governments for their own reasons, but it's something that we have to continue to push. The unfortunate thing is, you know, because most of the developed countries have been in this space of manufacturing for so long, they have mastered the art of kind of to the nth degree of being extremely competitive, high quality, high standards, and to compete with them, asking somebody to go and make a similar product on the side of the road in Accra or Nairobi is going to be quite tough. And so we're losing, if you like, on both sides. You know, we can compete on some of the manufactured goods, but then access into some of those markets on things where we believe we have strengths is also becoming a bit difficult. But having said that, there are exceptions that are negotiated, you know, within these conferences to make sure that markets are not flooded by those things as a way of killing some of the industries. The other thing I would mention is, I think non-tariff barriers are becoming the fashion of making it difficult to do trade across the world. People don't, you know, put tariffs up. They just make it inconvenient for you to do business. And you don't need to go very far. You know, within our own borders of East Africa, you know, a truck stays there for 1 day, 2 days. That's a non-tariff barrier. Somebody will say, well, why do I do business with this country, or why shouldn't I just go somewhere else? So I think for selected products, of course, there are certain tariffs, if for nothing else, to make sure that governments collect revenues. But as East Africa alone, we have reduced our tariff bans to only 3. 0 for raw materials if you are manufacturing, 10% for intermediate products, and 25% for finished products. Those are the tariffs that were only those 3 bands. They used to be hundreds, you know, many years back. And so those are ways of actually making sure that people understand, easy for people to do business, and transparent for everybody to have clarity, clarity on that. So I think those are some of the points I would make around the questions that you asked. I think on the issue of innovation, of how to increase the issues of trade and within the region, a lot is going on. You know, it's not only about use of technology, but it's about how to redesign your processes and how you make things work differently. A very good example of facilitating that is how the port of Mombasa was reorganized as a way of making things move faster. If there is a bottleneck at the port of Mombasa, doesn't matter what you do along the corridor on East Africa, it's going to be a problem. And so now the port of Mombasa, there is one single point of responsibility. You may not know this, but there are over 10, 15 government agencies, all of them reporting to different bosses in Nairobi. So a container would come, Kenya Revenue Authority have to check, they have a different reporting line, Bureau of Standards have to check, Poisons Board have to check, KEFIS, Kenya Plants and Health have to check, God knows, police have to check, NIS have to check, anti-drugs. So you can imagine, if you are the container owner, each of these people have to come. We asked them, why don't they all come at one time? Anyway, we took all that responsibility away from most of those people, and we had one point of accountability. The CEO of Kenya Ports Authority is now the overall boss. Everybody in the port reports to them, to that person. And so that's just really just one example of how we have redesigned some of our things to make sure things work better. Thank you.
Thank you. I think, Sam, I better turn to you here because there were some very specific questions coming out about financing of SMEs, about market access, financial incubation. Would you like to touch on that?
Yeah, thank you. I think in terms of SMEs, I think the question, I used the word shunted out. I think
in the past, a part of it, the thinking about SMEs has changed significantly in the last 2-3 years, I think, and it's been changing. I think previously it was very difficult. You talked about the kind of requirements an SME or anybody would be given would be absolutely similar to what you're demanding from a large corporate. This is no longer the case. I think for SMEs, and I think we ourselves have relooked a lot in terms of focusing on the SMEs. You have really focused SME teams that are looking at business very, very differently. We've looked into things like cash flow lending, which is happening. We have done innovation in things like invoice discounting for SMEs, where so long as they've got an order from particular people, we are able to look at the value chain and give them money against their invoices, etc. So there's been a lot of innovation, talking about innovation, around supporting SMEs. We agree more can be done. And if you look at even the issue of focus, you know, previously the idea was, I mean, there was no real focus on the SMEs. But there's a real recognition now that with 65%, 70% growth expected to come from that sector, you have to look at it. So I know we are looking at it, but we are not the only ones looking at it. I think I know at least 2-3 other banks, leading banks, that are very, very SME focused. So I think, in a sense, the focus has changed. The amount of money that we've put aside in SME funds is much more significant. We are partnering with other people even on products. For instance, we ourselves are even partnering for women specifically with Women's World Banking in terms of developing products for women SME holders. So I think there is a lot of partners even for other products, with other partners on products. Even our own procurement as an organization, previously the biggest bidder, whoever gave us the lowest price, got it. But we've actually said deliberately that we also have to encourage the SME sector. So there's a lot of thinking, a lot of changing. Even in the area of agriculture, which has been mentioned, we ourselves are investing a lot in agriculture. And one of the things we've realized about agriculture is we have tried to organize it. And there are SMEs in, even a lot of lending to agriculture was to large corporates, to flower farms. And we started seeing there are people who are working as SMEs within agriculture. The problem with that kind of sector is that it was not organized enough. So we ourselves are trying to order it, work with other partners who can create sense out of the fragmentation. If you look at like the tea sector, the reason smallholders and even SME players are able to get funding, it's because of the kind of organization that's there. So there's a bit of investment that's required to create a bit more order, to create structure, to defragment so that you can be able to lend. So all this effort going into all these areas, and we are seeing it bear fruit. When you look at our SME growth, it's actually going faster, much faster than our corporate. So there's a bit of a shift. But turning to East Africa specifically about East African trade, we realize that a lot of what goes on there is more around the corporates. And with the SMEs, for many SMEs, when you say you can trade in Kigoma, it's for a Kenyan SME. For most of them, it's a mystery. So I think there's a lot more that has to be done to encourage SMEs to look at the region as one. I think there's not enough information, not enough knowledge for the region. But for we ourselves, in terms of knowledge flows, in our Biashara and clubs, we've made them East African, so that people from Kenya, from Uganda, are able to travel to Rwanda. So we are doing a lot in terms of exposure. So before we would expose them to the China market, and every year we have, at least like this year, we've already had about 3 trips, some to Turkey, to Spain, to China. People like at least 2 trips to China. But we have more recently started going to Rwanda. We've taken people to Tanzania. So there is an aspect of exposure for SMEs, because many of them consider regional trade as maybe like international trade. It's too far. There are a few of them who are participating, but a lot more is supposed to be done by more people, I think even with government, by exposing SMEs to those markets. So I think there's some work to be done there so that they can also see the regional opportunity as opposed to just the local opportunity. So a lot of work is going on, but particularly in the regional space, a lot more needs to be done.
Sam, thank you very much for that. And I'm aware that we're now up against our time limit. So I would like to just thank the entire panel, thank the individual interventions, thank everybody for participating today, and leave you maybe with one final thought. One of my favorite quotes is by Victor Hugo, who says it takes a dream to create the future. And I think we're all dreaming here about a very, very great future for the whole of the African continent and for increased trade in the EAC. Thank you to my panelists. Waziri, Cabinet Secretary Aidan Mohammed, Sam Makomi of KCB, Managing Director of Kenya, James Murui, friend, Kenya National Chamber, economic diplomat as well, James Shikwati, renowned economist, and a new friend, Willie Cerrone of Pfizer. And thank you for that very interesting point you were making about the challenges about addressing smaller markets, which are fragmented. Thank you, and thank you everyone for being here today. Thank you.